All right, everybody. Welcome to Hoivan piiri Circles of Care. Yay! This is our last session before our grand finale in October. We will be having a three-day event. Inspired by these topics that we've been dealing with this Hoivan piiri. And today we're going to focus on soil. We have two wonderful speakers here today. And we'll be looking at soil, or the nurturing or caring for the soil, which we identify as the foundation of our existence. And the talks will be happening here in this space, but we would like to invite you with us outside for a small performative action or a ceremony of sorts, where we will get in contact with the rich living soil. But you don't need to know anything special. We will guide the situation and you can just focus on witnessing it. And since the topic of today is soil, we will start in the compost. So,
this stuff used to be plants, plant-based items, and now it is transformed into what we call soil.
So as you can see, we will we first have this small ceremony, or the beginning of the small ceremony. It will continue and further develop during this 1.5 hours. And we will then jump into have a little bit of overview what this Circles of Care actually is, and talk about a little bit of the topic, a little like prelude for the talkers. Mm-hmm. And then we have Sanna Hokkanen and Susan Ranneri both giving us approximately 30 minutes of insight to our day's topic.
Yes.
And we will end at 9 o'clock. And if you feel like it, you can be with us to somehow finalize the ceremony at 9 o'clock, which will take approximately 10 minutes. And unfortunately, there isn't time for collective discussion after the talks because of the timetable. But if you feel like there's something you want to ask or share during the talks, you can raise your hand and the presenter can then, when they find the space in the presentation, to ask the question or the comment. Yeah.
Before we go into the listening mode, we would like you to come and pick up your companion for tonight. So
please come here and take one cup and grab a handful of soil. So as you listen to these talks about soil and caring for soil, I encourage you to use many of your senses to be with the soil that you now have in the cup. You can touch it, you can smell it, you can watch it, maybe not taste it, but otherwise be present to it.
Mm.
You can take times during the talks when you maybe interact with it more, and then you can let it be for a while. And just remember that it's there.
Very good. And a few words about the Circles of Care before we hand out to the speakers. been motivated to do this because we want to seek new kinds of perspectives of care and caring in social influence. And we're interested in care in political action, not only as a starting point, but also as a goal of political action, and also as the means of the action. It consists of three events. The first one was investigating more of like self-care or caring of oneself, somehow outside the neoliberal context, and what would that be? And the second one was focusing on societal care and the care crisis that we're witnessing at the moment, a little bit at what care actually, what the definition means, and also how do we see it in our society and how we see the lack of it in society. And today, if we think about this as spheres or circles of care, we started from individual, going to society, and today it's the largest, which is the soil.
Which is all encompassing.
Yes. And the trinity of soul, society, and soil.
Soil.
Comes from Satish Kumar, who is this wonderful old Sri Lankan peace and environmental activist who has inspired us to, in his part, to us to do this task.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Series of
we have always, in the beginning, talked a little bit about our personal relationship to the topic of the day before handing over to the guest speakers. So now we also share a little bit of our personal insights to like what has led us to think about soil from a caring perspective. For me, one reason is that I've started to feel that one reason for environmental decay and climate change is a lack of compassion towards and lack of understanding of diverse life forms. And that includes microbial life forms, which are responsible for soil that can be a growing platform or like a place for growth. Then in comparison to the necessity to take care of ourselves or other humans and our social structures, I've begun to wonder whose responsibility is it to take care of soil? Because in our society, there are clear responsibilities, like often you think you are the one who should be taking care of yourself, or a parent is the one who should be taking care of a child, or the society or the state is the one who should be taking care of people who are sick. But who should be taking care of soil? Like, is anyone kind of nominated for that task? That's something that I wondered. And finally, I also think a lot about scale. The decay of farmland is so vast, so massive. Problem that we should all be demanding change to agricultural policy, but unfortunately that is not happening. Agricultural policy is not a sexy topic, and people are not demanding anything relating to it, or like very few people are. So I'm thinking what to do.
Yeah. Well, Alisa actually summed up quite a lot of things that I've been thinking of, or we've been actually thinking together a lot.
Yeah.
But maybe the only thing that I would like to add to that is somehow this idea of interdependency, which somehow intersects all of these layers. That the more I have personally started to think about the fact how dependent I, for example, am of the microbes, the bacteria, little creatures that actually turn the old plants back to nutrients, and for the new plants to grow, I start to have different kind of relation to it. And the more interconnected I become with the living environment that I inhabit, the more I start to care for of those relations and that they are healthy. Mm. And as long as I'm very detached from the soil or from other people, I don't care. It's not my responsibility. Yeah, but when I realize that actually we're all delicately interconnected, then your well-being becomes my well-being.
And the well-being of this becomes
yes.
our well-being.
Yeah.
That's our part. And now we welcome Sanna Hockenen. Actually, before that,
yes.
Who are we? Almost forgot.
Almost forgot, yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Yes, so I'm Aliin Satalja. I'm artist facilitator and one of the minds behind this Circles of Care series.
And my name is Samuel Laine. I'm a scenographer, the other mind of this series.
Yes. Today our roles are this.
Yes.
We have many roles in life.
Yes.
Yeah, but now, first speaker is Sanna Hockenen. Sanna is a doctoral researcher at the University of Helsinki. In her research, she examines the destruction of biodiversity and multi-species existences in Europe in the context of industrial agriculture and the EU's common agricultural policy, which is also known as CAP or CAP. Yes. Sanna will talk about or give us a broader context of kind of like a worldview or mindscape, what has led to the current situation and what has led to soil being so unwell. Welcome, Sanna.
Welcome.
Visible for the people at home. Yeah, thank you so much. I honestly can't think of like a better topic to talk about. We can love soil, and this place is just so cool to be here with all of you. So yeah, thanks to Samuli and Aliisa for organizing this and for the really good introduction. So on a practical note, I'll be giving today's talk in English, but I'll do a short introduction in Finnish as well. And one of the reasons I'm talking in English is because a lot of the agricultural policy making decisions are being made outside of Finland, outside of like respective countries. So yeah, a lot of the decision making happens in the European Union, which also then means that the work to try to counter those policies has to happen in English as well. So I'll be doing a weird thing of having my slides in Finnish on the side. So let's see how that works out. Maybe it won't. Okay, suomeksi. Mun nimi on siis Sanna Hockenen. Mä teen väitöskirjatutkijana töitä Helsingin yliopistolla globaalin kehitystutkimuksen oppiaineessa. Tämän lisäksi mä oon syntynyt ja kasvanut maaseudulla Keski-Suomessa maatilalla. Ja tämän illan puheessa mä tuun puhumaan maaperän ja monilaisen olemassaolon hävityksestä Euroopassa ja sitä, miten vallitsevat ja tämmöiset niin kuin, yhteiskunnan rakenteissa ja toimintamalleissa olevat perusolettamukset siitä, miten maailma on rakentunut, eli miten se toimii, mitä siinä on, miten asiat on yhteydessä toisiinsa, käytännössä ohjaa ja aiheuttaa tätä hävitystä. Ja mä tarkastelen tätä etenkin EU-yhteisen maatalouspolitiikan teollistuneen maatalouden kontekstissa, eli en maatalous yleisenä kaiken kattavana, vaan siis nimenomaan teollisen maatalouden kontekstissa. Ja mä tuun tekemään tämän tilan puheenvuoron englanniksi. Kysymyksiä saa esittää kummallakin kielellä. Okay. Joo, back to English. So, as we talked already before this, that the whole topic of soil is just so huge, and I noticed that when I started writing this talk, it just expanded, and it was really hard not to make this into a huge information dump, which I think just tells how major intersection soils and agriculture are for societies and the web of life in general. So in a way, makes sense that I want to talk about everything. So this talk is based on my research in exploring systemic and world historical foundations behind laws of life and landscape change in Europe related to industrial agriculture in Europe, which right now is mainly dominated by the European Union's Common Agricultural Policy, the CAP, which is this massive policy and subsidy program that determines a lot how agriculture is organized in Europe. And in this talk, like I said, I'm talking about Europe, but I think it's really important to note also that very similar and in some cases more destructive and more severe processes and agricultural practices are happening all over the world. And these are all representative of this wider world systemic and world historical process. And I think it's also really important to say that agriculture is not the only thing degrading soils, but because of more this general modernist progress-oriented systems of world making in general, through stuff like urbanization, infrastructural development, construction, deforestation, transformation of semi-natural habitats into these controlled socio-natures. So for example, transforming urban meadows into lawns, fuck lawns. Don't like lawns. So therefore the question of soil is not just a question of agriculture, but how our environments and our surroundings organized in general. Amazing. Do you want to check how far we are? Okay, a little bit about the agricultural policy. This is it. So part of my research is about making visible the multi-species worlds and relations around us and what makes human or human life possible as well. So I'll start by talking briefly about what we talk about when we talk about soils. This is amazing that you have the cup there, so you can like really tangibly like feel what I'm talking here now. So soils are important on a number of scales. So from the microprocesses of individual soil organisms to huge processes of storing carbon, water cycles, oceans, atmospheres, and soils are kind of like the skin of the earth, if the skin would also be the thing that feeds literally everyone. So the structure of the soil and the organic matter in it are the result of existence of different species, different beings living and dying in the soil. So the soil is not just habitat, it's not just the platform for those beings, but those beings actually make soil with the geological characteristics. So healthy soils are made up of a huge amount of different kinds of different species in these amazing networks of existence. So for example, in just a teaspoon of soil, which is way less than you all have in your cups, there's about a billion bacteria, thousands of fungi and single-celled organisms and nematodes, so these are wormy boys, and algae numbers can vary anywhere between 100 and 3 million in 1 gram of soil. And only 1% of all of these organisms have been identified, 1%. And in addition to the microlife that I was talking about, there's also the macrofauna of beings such as centipedes, millipedes, slugs, larvae, spiders, snails. So soils are entire worlds in themselves. So what soil scientists and agronomists, agricultural scientists describe through words like humidity, pH level, fertility, and clay and organic content are actually representations of specific multi-species assemblages and relations within the soil and with the geology of the land. Slight change. Thank you. So this is what healthy soils are made of. But in the last 5 centuries, and especially in the last century, we've seen a massive decline in bicultural diversity, which is driven by contemporary production and consumption systems, which are destroying multi-species life and the resiliency of all beings, humans included, and ecosystems. So what is basically happening is the loss of life and piling up of death in the web of life. And this is happening to soils as well. So in 2014, the UN Food and Agricultural Organization, FAO, said that if we were to continue at these current rates of soil loss, there would be only about 60 years of soils left, not 50, of harvests left, I mean. This is, of course, the kind of like worst case scenario, and it's not going to be, and it hasn't been this homogeneous process as that, but it does tell about the effects of a century-old systemic attack on soils and land. So right now, soils are being lost more than 100 times faster than they are being formed in cloud areas, and also 10 to 20 times faster even in non-cloud areas. And this is already showing in the decreased productivity of fields. So what is happening globally is something much bigger than any of those formal official statistics on extinction and biodiversity loss suggest. The loss of life, of which soil loss is also part of, are particular forms of extinction. So they're not only or not even mainly about extinction about related to a species completely disappearing from the face of the earth, but they're more like destructions that make worlds die and worlds that existed in complex relations between huge number of beings in all kinds of landscapes. Slight change. Oh yeah, and this is my favorite. It's not just humanity or agriculture in general. And it's really, yeah, so it's really important to note that behind all of this, this is not the result of humans just being humans or agriculture as just a way of providing food. But what's behind the loss of soils are the dominant forms of industrialized agriculture as part of a wider, but specific world historical and mainly capitalogenic, so derived from capitalism, destruction of the web of life. So this destruction is not also a side effect of anything, but the direct result of conscious, active decisions in the current production systems aimed for continual growth and capital accumulation. Slide change, thank you. Thanks, Mika. So how does this show in all of our surroundings? So there are a lot of studies showing how the European farmland and European landscapes in general have gone through these massive changes in the last few centuries, especially in the last 100 years. So these changes have long roots in the industrialization of societies and the specific understandings and dominant imaginaries that view soils and nature apart from humanity and as a passive resource. And these understandings of society and nature and soils are in practice institutionalized into societies and into the landscapes we now know through quite rapid projects of mechanization of agriculture, intensification and commercialization of farming. So from family farms, industries, the active globalization and commercialization, which cheapens the food market, as well as farmland abandonment and farmland expansion, both driven by policy programs such as the Common Agricultural Policy. So agricultural land use has intensified both locally, which means the increased use of chemicals and fertilizers and a higher cropping intensity, and at the landscape level. So this means that the expansion of monocultures, meaning that only one crop is farmed on one field in one year, year after year, changing multiple small fields into bigger ones, simplification of farmlands in general, which has meant the elimination of rotational farming practices, cover crop farming, and the elimination of landscape elements and different habitats in a farmland. So, for example, field margins, ponds, trees, grasslands, streams, hedges, which used to be this normal part of rural landscapes everywhere, not anymore to that extent. And similar changes have also happened to pastoralism and livestock rearing. So agricultural modernization has to a large extent decreased diversity of livestock species and moved animals from pastures and grasslands to indoor facilities, quite often factories, meaning that animals went from being beings within the farming landscape, within networks of multi-species existence, and having a role also in the crop production and soil health, into commodities that are encased into indoor factories. A large part of these, all of these changes have happened only within three generations. So within the generations that we personally know. Slight change, thank you. And what all of these changes have meant for soil is that within industrial agriculture, the major part of agricultural plants is harvested and removed from fields every single year. So fields are in a way every single year stripped bare, and whatever is left of the plant mass is not enough to cover the loss of the organic matter and humus in the soil. So like a researcher, Anna, this is a really hard name, Krzysztofinski maybe, has said, what industrial and intensive farm agriculture does, it essentially mines the soils of its nutrients and organic matter. And this leads to the loss of micro and macro life and degradation of root systems and fungi mycelium. So with this monotonous production year after year of only one crop at a time on huge fields, coupled with intense plowing and summer fallowing, so meaning that nothing is sown on it, soil structure will eventually be nearly or completely wiped out. But this mining of the soil is not the only problem with intense farming, because monocultures also require massive amounts of fertilizers and pesticides, because cultivating the same crop on the same field will lead to weeds and plant diseases, because the natural processes of plant protection through biodiversity are reduced or completely eliminated. So in a way, monocultural agriculture is creating weeds and pests that wouldn't exist in biodiverse areas. So to combat these unwanted weeds and pests, unwanted producers start to use all kinds of combinations of herbicides, pesticides, fungicides, which do lead to, like they do definitely lead to short-term successes for a couple of decades maybe, now coming to the end, but actually creates a dependency on fertilizers and pesticides in the long run. And we're currently seeing this. And even if you do this super selectively, it always impacts and often kills countless number of other micro and macro fauna in the soil. So to put it simply, intensive agricultural practices like monocultures pave the way for soils to become stripped and sick of their multi-species life. So right now there are almost no soils left in Europe that are not contaminated by a cocktail of several chemicals, which include forever chemicals that do not decompose or whatever the word is, but will continue on moving in the web of life. And as a result, a large part of the European farmlands have become what anthropologist Anna Ting calls industrial landscapes that kill off beings that are not recognized as assets. So the effects are also much wider and seep and travel beyond these fields and beyond these farmlands, which is evident in a massive decline of bird and insect population, sometimes called as insecticide in Europe, and as well as in the pollution of waterways. On a landscape level, for example, in Belgium, almost all of the country's rivers have become so polluted by industrial agriculture that the government is saying that no one should swim in those rivers, and that there are some streams in which the water itself could be classified as a pesticide. So what we're seeing is this massive homogenization, simplification of agricultural practices, and along with that, the simplification of life and multi-species existence. And the important thing to note is that policy tools and the subsidy programs within the CAP has pressured all farmers of all sizes to take up the use of heavy fertilizers and modify landscapes. I'm wondering if, no, this is totally the same slide. Yeah, to modify landscapes to accommodate this kind of simplified and efficient cropping and high mechanization of farming. So the question is not just about small scale, large scale farming, but more about this normalized image of what is seen as efficient, good, right kind of farming. And the farmers often have no other option to take part in this, because the commercialization of agriculture, the introduction of huge agricultural corporations has cheapened and led to this massive cheapening of food in general. So small-scale farmers are forced to take part in a form of farming which was actually designed for industrial-sized corporate farming. So for many farmers, the agricultural development driven by the EU's CAP has led to a situation to either intensify and mechanize or stop farming completely. Slight change, please. So why the hell is the CAP like this? And how does this all relate to stuff like food security and farmers' livelihoods? So the Common Agricultural Policy, when it was founded after the Second World War, was a good thing maybe, because it was aimed at building food security and secure fair wages for the farmers. But since its very earliest reforms, it has become more like a main tool for corporate-led agriculture and export-oriented agribusiness. And this is really easy to see by just following the money. So CAP represents around 30 to 40% of the EU's entire budget. So the entire European Union's budget, about a third of that goes into CAP. And of that, 80% of all of those funds go to only the largest 20% of farms, which at that size are mostly corporate farms. So instead of promoting this sustainable farming and investing in rural communities, most of the money benefits just a few large producers and is failing to serve a majority of farmers and rural landscapes. So a lot of this is because of this major lobbying done by super influential big farm and agribusiness lobby groups like the COGECA, together with pesticides and food industry representatives, who, for example, now have been super strongly fighting against new policies like the EU's farm to fork strategy and biodiversity strategy. So these lobby groups are in practice actively working against changes in the CAP, which actually would increase farmers' incomes, support local food production, and allow the cutting of pesticides and fertilizer use in farming. And these policies, which are detrimental to soils, can't really be justified with being beneficial for farmers either, because the potential caretakers of the soil. And this is exemplified by the fact that since the beginning of the year 2000, every 10 years, around 4 million farms have stopped their activity or gone bankrupt in the European Union. That is 400,000 per year. And now half of all EU farmland is controlled by farmers over 100 hectares in size. And what this trend means for soils is that when a farm size grows, farms tend to specialize in monocultural cereal cropping and livestock production and move away from rotational and mixed farming, as well as pastoral livestock rearing, which would be all better for soil health. And the form of agriculture promoted in CAP can't really be justified with food security either, to a large part, of course, exactly because it destroys the soils, but because Europe has already for a really long time been producing surplus. So European Union is exporting food that is producing. And a lot of the policy tools within the CAP are actually still about continuing this export-oriented business model of agriculture. So the basic principles of agriculture, what are at the root of agriculture, which is providing food for all and providing the livelihood for the farmers, have become to be treated as secondary principles in comparison to food and land as community and food commodity and food and land as a way to make a profit. So as you can maybe see, for decades and decades, care has been nowhere near dominant agricultural politics in the EU, neither towards other than human species, nor for the people actually doing the farming. So that is a little bit about how the CAP is currently, but in my research, I'm also mostly interested in the very foundational reasons and thought systems which guide how societal life is lived and how large-scale systemic processes like industrial agriculture get started and why are they shaped as they are. Slide change, please. So the erasure of soils and the loss of attentiveness to their needs is rooted in early industrialization and knowledge systems during and before that time. So some of the very most basic fundamental assumptions which current societies, economies, and politics are founded on are ideas like society and nature as separate things from each other, human exceptionality, so humans as somehow like exceptional, unique, separate from the rest of the web of life, and the idea of a world as a mechanistic entity rather than this relational whole where things are connected and dependent on each other. And there are also some very even more specific assumptions behind current agricultural practices related to soil, which can be actually traced pretty well in scientific and political history. So for example, researcher Greta Marchesi and Anna Krzyzewski have examined that the way how soils are currently treated in industrial agriculture and society in general is to a large extent founded on the theories of soil fertility introduced by this German guy, Justus von Liebig, who was a chemist who became known as the kind of father of modern agricultural science in the 1840s. So von Liebig's work in chemistry in the mid-1800s introduced this mineral understanding of soil rather than organic or humus-based. So von Liebig said that for soils to grow food, they only needed a combination of few chemical elements, and that adjusting this chemical cocktail of the soil with mineral additives, which in practice has mainly meant nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, was the only thing needed for productive and healthy soil. So this was then applied to agriculture, and it still forms the basis of agronomic knowledge today, meaning that the soils are treated as this passive medium, passive platform for growing crops, which completely ignores things like oxygen in the soil, the structure, humidity, and the billions and billions of beings that make and inhabit the soil. So Krzyzewski and Marchesi continue by saying that von Liebig's work on plant growth was super, super revolutionary at that time because it really simplified the question of how to enhance yields. And this was really useful for European countries at that time because they were aiming to industrialize and feed growing populations and elate the, and because this von Liebig's idea then laid the foundation of a form of agricultural knowledge and science that could be universalized everywhere into this kind of one size fits all agriculture. So that's why von Liebig's ideas and other similar thinking came to form the backbone of modern industrial farming. And this reductionist simplified thinking of soils that has its roots in this Western rationalistic knowledge systems didn't arise because they were according to the best available scientific knowledge or according to the best practices known by farmers at that time, but because the thinking served the interests of industrializing societies and early capitalism. So we are now living within those landscapes that have been changed and created according to these logics. So the normality we now know in landscapes and in farming practices is actually a product of specific false conceptions of how the world is and of a century of policies and processes guided by those and aimed at extracting as much as possible from lands and soils. Slight change, please. And all of this, of course, relates to societies on a more general level, your life, my life, everyone's. So this is because Marchesi continues by saying that as this chemical-based farming allowed farms to become more larger and more productive and less labor intensive, it made possible for people to move from rural landscapes to cities and work in cities in industries. So the industrial revolution and the scale of urbanization that we now know are actually and first and foremost founded on the agricultural revolution prior to that. So the growth of cities and the mass migration of people from rural areas very much happened because of the kind of agriculture, of agricultural change and mechanization, scaling up of yields following from intensive fertilizer use. But because this form of agriculture is currently coming to its end, has to come, exactly because it mines and destroys soils, it will have foundational effects also on what the future of all societal life will be. Mm. So this is because, like environmental historian Jason Moore says, the farmer or the Wall Street is just as dependent on the web of life as is the farmer, and so is an urban hipster in Kallio. So the need to care for soils for the sake of being able to continue to produce food at all is not a question about ideologies or which kind of possible agricultural forms we choose, but rather that the current mode promoted in the EU's agricultural policy is just not possible and it can't be sustained and will lead to major crises in the food system, already has. But there are, of course, changes happening and a lot of farmers would like to do things differently. But the problem is that the current cap and the way how societies or subsidies are given out doesn't support that and actually blocks or hinders that. And in addition, the way food production is organized physically within countries, within landscapes. So for example, that crop farming and livestock farming are happening in different places. So the shit is in the wrong place. And that production is often quite far away from consumption. So food is not consumed locally, as well as the dependence on the currently farmed crops on chemical fertilizers, which are kind of like technological lock-ins in the current system. Because of these, it demands major efforts to then come out of this, which majority of farmers, which are already currently struggling, don't have the capacities for. So as researcher Christina Leon argues, growing food for humans necessarily means caring for a whole world of organisms, beings, and elements, not about conserving things. And this also means that rural families and communities have to regain some level of autonomy from these chemical companies and from aid packages like the CAP in its current form. Slight change. Yeah, so a core characteristic to kind of come to the end of this talk, a core characteristic of the thinking of how the world works and at the foundation of modern industrial agriculture and agricultural politics is primarily about reducing the world to a simplified form of itself, of soils into dirt, of landscapes into passive areas, of farming into production of things. And that is why a lot of the work for caring for soils, caring for land has to start with noticing all the beings that make life around and within us, and acknowledging all the relations and connections that make life possible, both for people and all other beings. And this attention and this careful way of doing and being, of knowing where food comes from, and knowing the complex and dynamic relations between humans and non-human beings is in itself a form of caregiving. But this is not just or even primarily an individual act or reserved only for farmers, but rather a collective struggle that we all have to take part in, because these forms of caregiving are being actively destroyed by contemporary economic structures and agricultural politics. And this is why sustainable agriculture, a care for cares for soils, cannot be coupled with market capitalism and growth economies, because they are founded on cheapening of food and mining the web of life for as much as possible. And it's really important to remember that care for soils and health for soils are not just yet again one more additional thing on top of, for example, climate emergency that we need to consider and take into account when thinking about all of these current global crises, but to remember that soils and food production are the very foundation, are the very foundation on which everything else in societies and our lives is standing on. And I'd like to end my talk with a quote from one of my favorite poets, Wendell Berry, who is also a farmer himself. If you want to change the slide. The soil is the great connector of lives, the source and destination of all. It is the healer and restorer and resurrector by which disease passes into health, age into youth, death into life. Without proper care for it, we can have no community, because without proper care for it, we can have no life. Mm. Thank you. I feel really privileged to be able to talk about these things with unlike other people here with me.
So cool.
Wow, Anna.
Yes, that was.
Thank you so much. That was so insightful and exactly what we asked you to talk about.
And much more.
And much more. Yeah. Exactly what we asked and much more.
Cool. Yeah.
Yes, wonderful.
Very intense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I realize you want to shake it up.
Yeah.
My brain is going to be buzzing today.
Yeah. Yes. And we have another
speaker
today, giving a little bit different perspective, maybe more from a more personal level, could I say. We have Susan Rannari. She is the executive director of Luomuliitto, an organization of organic producers, right? And lives in a biodynamic farm in Maivik. Susan will talk about the care of soil in practice and what could be done to increase taking care of soil.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
The previous presentation and also the people, I can't remember your names anymore. it was really, really good prepping for my talk. Now, there is like some elements that I feel that are highly, highly important, and I also took this cup with me. But let's see now. I was thinking that when I saw this description for this event and about compassion towards soil, that how is it possible to have compassion towards soil? And to be able to have compassion towards soil, you have to have a connection, and you have to have a relationship. And that's crucial. And you also have to have an understanding. You have to somehow be able to see and hear soil to be able to be compassionate. And so this is now my perspective, at least where I start. That how are we able to have a connection with soil? How are we able to see and hear it and to understand it? And this was a really good example to go to the compost and to have, and also your presentation. You were talking a lot about the organic matter in soil, but actually in the agricultural school, when we look at soil, we put it usually like there is like two main groups. There is the organic matter, and then there is this mineral side, or that if you, we've all been, when we've been kids, we've been playing in these sandboxes with only sand. So actually soil is a combination of the organic matter and some kind of sand structure. If it's really, really fine, the sand, then it's actually clay. Mm. And then when it becomes bigger, and then we can have huge rocks, and it's that same stuff, but only in different scale. But this then, the organic matter, we saw it so nicely in the compost, that there was on top of the compost, there was decaying plant materials. And in the bottom, we have this humus. And you can actually see, and you were talking a lot about life and death. This is like when you think about a plant, for example, and if you think about how do you define life and death, what is alive and what is dead? If you think about like dead soil, you think about something like sand and so on. But when you think about the dead plant, then it becomes very complicated, because all of a sudden we feel that this is actually alive, but it's dead plants. And then we come into this like circle of that life actually continues throughout. So, but in agricultural school, we learn that healthy soil, it looks like raejuusto we have in Finland. You can buy it in shop. And now when I took from my cup, so here's a big piece now. But if I slightly, it's really hard piece. But this rest, if this would be white, it could almost be like raejuusto. And we know that this is very much alive. So you were talking about the content of the humus, what it contains. It's not, it's a lot of life happening here. And that life is making this structure, the raejuusto structure, what we are aiming for. Yeah, so this is somehow what we need to have a connection. And when we got this, I smiled inside when you were encouraged to touch and smell, but not maybe taste. But I have to say that personally, I wouldn't even be afraid to taste this. That it's quite common that. I at home just pick up something from the wildlife and put it into my mouth, and it contains soil. Very much alive. Yes, it's also something what I have done in my work. We in Luomuliitto we organize the organic days, and it's a 2-day event for the organic farmers. And many times we have been planning that we would like to have a researcher that would have done some research, that is there a connection about what you were saying, is there a connection with the microbe life in the soil and the human health? Mm-hmm. There is very little research among this topic, and of course it's a hard topic to research, but it's a very interesting topic. So this is one thing I wanted to tell you. So we have to know the soil and understand the humus, understand how it becomes. We have to recognize what is good and healthy. We have to understand that it contains also other stuff than the organic matter. So now you know that. Then, and we have also an understanding of death and life, and that it's not so definite also always. Another thing what I usually talk about, that I wish that everyone would understand. It's something that you learn, I think, in between the 7th and 9th grade, or maybe even earlier in school, but it's photosynthesis. Like, everyone should know that by heart. But unfortunately, people don't know and forget. Remember that green plants, they take carbon dioxide, they use the sun and make like sugars, they make food for us. That's the process that is like, is life. And when we talk about carbon sequestration, that's the most difficult English word ever. And so that is what is happening. The green plants ties up the carbon back. And then when it's composted, it's back into the soil. And it is there, instead of in our atmosphere making this planet warming up. Okay, yes. So now we got minerals, humus, life, death, and photosynthesis. Okay, clear, good. So let's see now. So, I had this speaker coach that taught me that when I talk about stuff, I should always talk about that what, and then also to take up so what if we don't take care of the soul? So what? Why is it important? And I think you quite well came already up with the reasons. So what happens if we're not taking care of the soil? Maybe it's good also that you have a connection into healthy soils. So how does then a sick soil look like? How does the earth, and how does the farmers, how does a farmer recognize that this is not okay? What is good? Then how do you recognize that? And one really simple thing how you recognize is that water don't go through. When it rains a lot, the water stays on the surface. And it's because of this pliosto structure. It's lacking that. It's packed. So this is really essential, this pliosto structure. That is what farmers are like aiming for when they want to make the soil more healthy. So water doesn't go through, the plants doesn't grow, and also you can recognize unhealthy soil from the smell. It smells bad. Yes. When you smell of this, earthy kind of. It's earth. It's okay. It could be bad, but the compost has been taken care of. Well, so there has been a good balance of air. The composting process needs air, and the soil needs air. So then it smells good. Yes. But let's talk a little bit more about the farmer. I was first planning on this, what I should talk about in Finnish. forgot that this was in English until I came here and I had to start to think about these keywords all of a sudden. But I was, when I was planning this, then I was taught when farmer in Finnish is maanviljelijä. It's like earth farmer. It says so much, maanviljelijä, what the farmer is supposed to do. It's supposed to take care, like, firstly of the soil. And then from that comes the harvest and yields. Yes, but the farmer, what is he doing? Well, he's, the society thinks things and not even the cap really, but society, I guess, thinks that the farmer's main task is to grow food. And the farmer is getting paid paid for the produced kilo. The more kilos he is producing, he is getting his salary and from the subsidies. So that's the combination, from the sold kilos and the subsidies. And nobody is really talking about the quality nutritions. And nobody is really not talking that the farmer is one of the foremost person taking care of the soil, and nobody is paying for that.
Mm.
So that's a really, really difficult. So all our when the money is coming from the kilos and from not other like things, so. Then of course all our like efforts have been going to like produce more kilos. And then we get tomatoes that don't really taste anything. And in that way the farmer is trying to make a best income possible. But if we think of the farmer, that the farmer is the soil keeper and the soil carer, so and think that what could he do to make better? You were talking a lot about the industrial agriculture and what have been done, so the soils have become poor. So it's really the opposite that has to be done. And this ain't rocket science. We know what we're supposed to do. It's no secret. So we call like these methods are called regenerative practices. And it's really like three things. It's adding organic matter. So we get more humus, yes. It's not, we have to avoid packing the soils. And then we try. We have to try to have the fields covered with crops as much as possible. So these are the three things. That's simple. And if we would a little bit look in deeper into these three things, that what could they be in practice? So adding organic matter. How can we add organic matter in the field? Well, one is crop rotation. You were talking about monoculture. Crop rotation is the opposite. That we do have other, like many different crops, and we also have crops that adds on. That we have like grass, for example, and we have faba, oh my god, palkokasvit. What's palkokasvit?
Pulses.
Pulses, yes. That take, adds nitrogen to the soil by itself. So So we vary crop rotation one, and then manure. You were talking already about that, that we have the livestock on the wrong side. In Finland, we have the livestock up north because of the subsidy system, and here in south where we have cereal farming more, we don't have so much animals. So it would be good somehow to get manure more evenly and have animals more evenly. And then, of course, we have these recycled fertilizers. So from different industries, organic matter that can we have from the forest industry, we have from the different food industry, like organic matter. Where there is organic matter, then that should be composted and delivered back to the soils, right? And not into some piles somewhere. And then this packing, not to pack the peels. What do we again need? Well, crop rotation. So crop rotation to rotate crops with different root systems. We need to have in the crop rotation crops with very deep roots that put this good structure, for example. We need to use light machines. We need to be very careful when we go on the field that it's the right timing. And then, of course, minimize tilling. You were talking about that too, that turning over and over and over again, it's not good for the soil. Need to let it be a little bit. Okay, and then with the cover crops, you were also talking about that. So what do we have there? Well, we have crop rotation. So there, yes, and we have other things also. We can have many different like layers, for example. We can have clover under and cereals on top. We can have layers, and then we can have, if we have, like, for example, potato and take them out quite early, then put something after that. So it's just to be mindful that to have all the time something, and then when we take out the from the field, that we then sow something else to have it covered. And especially in Finland with the long winter, it would be really, really good that we would have crop cover during winter time. That would be essential. Yes, so it's not really, really, this is knowledge we have and what we know. Yes, and because I come from the Organic Farmers Association, I have to then say that within the organic rules, crop rotation is a must. All the organic principle is built on top of crop rotation. And on top of that, then it's not allowed to use chemical fertilizations or any chemical herbicides or pesticides. No chemical inputs. Only organic. So we have a system which have been developed now for about 40 years. And sometimes I get at least frustrated that we have a system and also which works quite well within the market. Also, it's from these sustainable agricultural labels, it's the most commonly known globally that people recognize it, and it has a quite even standard globally. So like here and somewhere around on the other side of the globe, when we talk about organic agriculture, we talk approximately about the same thing. Yes. Okay. Let's see what else. Yes. So then, when we're talking about life, death, humus, minerals, photosynthesis, we've been talking about now the farmer and the farmer's possibilities to take care. So let's talk about the impact now and what the people in the city could do. So people in the city, there is like, I think like I've been now taking here like three different aspects. That of course, all of us are consumers and we make choices with the how we consume, what we buy. So as a consumer, of course, to buy organic, that's one thing. But also to grow your own food as much as possible. That's also a good way to make a connection with soil. And also buy straight from the farmer. One interesting thing what I think a person from the city as a consumer could do is also to engage in this CSA activities to go and unite with the farmer and start to farm themselves, but in a little bit of bigger scale. We have some nice community supported agriculture cases here in Helsinki also, and they are getting more popular. I somehow see that the only way is that to get the connection is that you have to come closer to the food production to really understand. Somehow you join peace around the food table with nature and with soil, but just buying packages from the supermarket it doesn't work like that. Yes. Another way to have an impact is to impact in decision making. As a voter, as a person in a municipality, maybe as a parent somewhere, or as a worker, I think we have entered a time where we have to demand a change everywhere we go. And that's where we are. And maybe it feels a little bit uncomfortable somewhere, maybe as a parent, in a kindergarten, to be demanding that I want in our kindergarten organic food, or in the municipality that, hey, I want that our city starts to buy more sustainable. But that's really the only way, I think. And if we do it together, maybe it's not so hard. Yes. So I've been talking a lot. I had hoped that someone would ask me some questions. There is. I hope you've been seeing the pictures going here. They are all from different organic farms doing a great job around in Finland. Yes. But yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Suzanne. That was splendid. I think it also gave a very nice different perspective, because we had this very broad macro picture first, and yes. You took it to
human scale.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. And also now there was a lot of talk about the problems that we're facing, but also, as you said, it's not rocket science that what should we be doing to the soil to make the agriculture better. And there was already some points of how we can tackle this problem also here as citizens in a city. I mean, this is of course one where somehow I feel in the future already when we're inside of this. And the fact that we need to build these kind of communities where we are in contact with the farmer itself, and that there's more this kind of a direct interaction. So we build this kind of communities. And then together we can also join forces to tackle COP, for example. There is different kind of initiatives already existing. I, for example, belong to We Move Europe. I'm in a mailing list and they give me, it can be a petition, but sometimes it's like, hey, there's this thing happening. For example, focusing on the agricultural policies, that you should target these key politicians, send them an email. And this is like, it takes me half an hour to formulate it and send it. And if there is 1,000 people doing this, it's already something. It's a lobbying that we can use this kind of people power, because there is this big business people going in there, they have direct action, not direct like connection with the people, but then we can, if we tweet to the person also, there's 100 tweets about this decision that needs to be made tomorrow. And of course, we need to be care of how we communicate with them. So we should be communicate, of course, with compassion and love, and not being like, you fucking asshole.
Yeah.
But I'm like, have you considered this from this side of perspective?
Yeah.
But yeah, I think because we don't have really time for discussion, and our time is more or less done. I would like to thank both of our speakers and the people who don't need to hurry home or wherever else they would need to hurry. We have a small ending ceremony.
Yes.
And after that, if there is some kind of discussion that you want to have, at least we will be here for a bit longer so we can chat in a more formal setting. So,
yeah.
Do you want to guide us?
I will guide us. So if you need to leave and you don't want to take part in the common ending and you want to wash your hands, it's possible indoors. But if you have some more, 15 more minutes, then those of you who maybe came later and perhaps don't have your cup of soy, please come and get a cup of soy.
Accompanied us tonight, it belongs here. We have now donated it, some of our skin microbes, and perhaps received some of its microbes, as well as some new perspectives in relation to Sana's and Susan's talks. So please choose a box to pour your soil into, and once you've found your box, moment to reflect on the relationship that emerged tonight between you and this cup of soil with its billions and zillions of critters and organisms. Then give the soil to the plants. And stay for a while.
Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight.
Thank you.
Thank you.